and flooded all of creation, right down to this very day. Must have been quite a bang, huh? Perhaps a big bang, you could say. Huh? And as the light sped through the nascent universe, it pushed the boundaries, ever expanding outwards, filling all of creation with God's light. God said, "This is good." God said it. Must be true, huh? Now, Genesis continues with God's story of creation. As we know, day and night, that happened on the first day also. Second day were created the heavens and the oceans and the continents and the trees on the third day, and the stars and the sun and the moon on the fourth day, and the fifth day saw the creation of the fishes and the birds, and on the sixth day the beasts of the earth in the morning. And God said, "This is all good. Good stuff." But was God just having fun, do you think? He was. But God's inscrutability is beyond our ken, even though God desires to reveal himself to us in his creation. So much so that on the sixth day after lunch, in the afternoon, God created his pinnacle of creation, mankind. Man and woman, in his own image, God created them. Image and likeness, God created. And he gives to that part of his creation the stewardship of the earth, all the animals, the whole environment, all the plants, minerals and resources. God gives it all to his own creation in his image. Does God say this is good? No, actually he doesn't. He says this is very good. So God rested on the seventh day, we know that in Genesis. Well, whether all that happened in exactly 6 days or 24 hours each or not, or over millions of years, it really doesn't matter. God did it. What matters is that God spoke. He began his story. And down the ages, priests, prophets, and kings have, as God's servants, continued writing another chapter or two all through the Old Testament, until Jesus is born on that Christmas night through Joseph's ancestry, a descendant of King David, a descendant of Abraham himself. God spoke his complete word in Jesus, his son, so complete that we call Jesus the Word of God. Huh? And that Word of God, how different from the Big Bang in Genesis, creeps into the created world as a mewling infant, wrapped in rags, laid in straw in the manger, and nobody even notices. Certainly not the supposed God Emperor Caesar Augustus, who ordered the census, nor his hegemon Quirinus. And the innkeepers in Bethlehem certainly didn't care either. There was no room for you guys. So silent is that night of the Lord's birth. So indifferent is God's creation to the genesis of salvation that an angel has to be sent to the shepherds to summon them down from the fields. Come! Go and see the Savior, who is Christ the Lord. At least somebody pay attention. And at that moment, the heavens are filled with angels singing praises of God and praying for peace on earth. So God's story continues to unfold. As Christ is born, God invites us into his story to continue speaking the word and to participate fully in the development of our future. Abraham, King David, and the prophets, and the great men and women of the Old Testament were more or less only spectators. They didn't know God's plan for them. Even though they had the Torah, they had the Ten Commandments, and they had the other laws in the Old Testament to guide them. Even though they had the histories of their people, and they had the prophets continually speaking to them, bring, come back, come back, come back, but wandering off did some of those kings in the Old Testament wander off? Some of those prophets also wandered off, did awful things. Even though they had the Psalms and the books of wisdom, magnificent prayers to help them to pray, which we still use today, none of those were chosen to visit Christ in the manger. Just the shepherds. None of them were chosen to follow Christ like St. Peter and St. Paul and the other apostles. None of them were invited to the Eucharistic feast, eat my body and drink my blood, like you and me, as we are invited tonight. The angel calms the fears of the shepherds, who are naturally terrified. Bleak midwinter night, frosty winds, suddenly seeing the glory of God shine out all around. Their own big bang, perhaps, huh? Of course they're terrified. Terror lurks in darkness. God sends his light to overcome darkness. So much. The shepherds leave their sheep on the hillsides, scuttle down the hill to Bethlehem. It's exactly as the angel told them. They found the baby lying in the manger, wrapped in swaddling cloths. They saw and they believed. What do you see? And what do you believe? We see the sacraments. We see the church. We see the faithful gathered in the church for the sacraments. What we see, what do we believe? We believe that God has chosen his church and given the church the sacraments so the priests and people together may continue the story of God's love in this world. Each of us has his own big bang moment, the moment when we realize that God really exists and he loves me. The moment when we realize that I'm not God. There's something better than me. The moment when we opened up and let the light of God's big bang, his power and his love, flood into our hearts. The moment when we said, I believe, and meant it. Not, I believe this bit and that bit, not too happy about that bit of the church. No. Even if that bit's difficult, we believe it. Because we believe what the church teaches us. And our society does encourage us to pick and choose. Well, I like this, I like that, I don't like this, I don't like that. Our society encourages us to disdain the difficult in favor of the easy way out. Society says, be happy. The church says, as Christ's body here in church, be right and do right, even if that doesn't make you happy. Happiness doesn't mean anything. The church says, did you make a commitment? Well, yes, when I was baptized, I made a commitment. Then keep it, because that's right. You may not always be happy if you keep what's right, but you will always be blessed by God. What are the commitments? Were you confirmed? Were you reconciled to God? Did you make your first Holy Communion? Are you married? Are you ordained? Have you ever been anointed with the oil of the sick? In every single sacrament, God makes a commitment to us through his church. And he asks us to make that commitment back to him. We can't possibly make as great a commitment as God, but we can do one. We can make a commitment that is honorable. And as we honor our commitment to God, we write the next chapter of God's story. If we tell that story well, we keep our commitments well, others will listen and be drawn to the love of God through us.